Hey, Charles, you got a second?
Sure, man. What's up?
Well, I've been writing these unit tests, just like you showed me, but I don't know, man. They're starting to feel kind of messy.
Let me take a look.
So, looking at your test class, I see that it's called Inventory Tests, and it looks like you're taking advantage of nested classes. So we have the Add Bag and Remove Bag classes nested. So that leads me to believe you've got the inventory as your system under test, and then you're testing both the Add Bag method and then the Remove Bag method, respectively. Is that right? Yep, that's right. Awesome. And I can also see that you're using fluent assertions, which is great because your assertions are very clear. I see that after you've added a bag to this inventory that has space for one bag, that the list of bags should include that bag. So that's great. And scrolling down, I can tell that you're basically having to instantiate an inventory with multiple different states in order to test this add bag method under different conditions. And you know what? I think I can see where the problem may lie. In order to create an inventory that has space for multiple bags, you need to instantiate multiple bags and then pass them into the constructor in a very particular way. Now, the constructor for bag is pretty simple. It seems to only take an integer called capacity. But even with just that one parameter, your test is already looking a little bloated. In other words, the problem here is that your creational logic is too complex, and it's sort of muddying up the waters of your test. And I can imagine that if you were to add even more parameters to the bag constructor, that this will get even harder to follow.
And not to mention, harder to maintain too.
Exactly. So what do I do?
You know what? I think I've got just the thing to solve your problem. It's called the builder pattern.
The builder pattern? What's that?
The builder pattern is a design pattern that separates the construction of a complex object from its representation. It's typically used to encapsulate the creation of different variations of the same object. But in our case, we can use a subset of the pattern to make all of your hard-to-follow creational logic much more expressive and easier to follow too.
That sounds great. Where do we begin?
Let's start by creating a builder for the bag class, since it's so simple. After that, we'll move on to the inventory class so we can start refactoring these tests. Once we have those in place, I'll show you a cool trick that'll make these tests way more expressive and easier to read. Sound good?
Yeah, sounds good to me.
Awesome. Let's start by adding a new class to our test project. We're going to call it Bag Builder. Now, the most important method on our builder class is the build method that returns an instance of the object that our builder is in charge of building. So we're just going to return for now a new bag. It looks like the bag class's constructor takes an integer called capacity. So the idea is, instead of passing this value in on the constructor, we'll make this more explicit by providing a method called withCapacity, just to encapsulate the setting of that value. Now, what's key here is that we don't actually want to return void. We want to return the bag builder, so we can chain multiple methods like this along. If we add more properties to bag that need to be set on the constructor, like maybe max capacity and min capacity and things like that, we can add them as methods to the bag builder and then string them along, building the bag as we go with a more expressive interface. Of course, we aren't doing anything just yet with this method, so what we're going to need to do is create a private field to hold the capacity, which we'll set in the withCapacity method, and then use when the build method is called. Let's go ahead and switch back to the inventory test and use our new builder. So we'll just go ahead and pick the first one here. I'm just going to replace this creation logic with a call to our bag builder. So we'll say new bag builder with capacity 1.build, and that is going to produce a bag.
It doesn't look that much better, to be honest.
I know, don't worry. This is only one step. We're just laying down the groundwork.
Okay, I'm going to trust you on this.
You'll see, we're going to add some really cool syntactic sugar. But first, why don't we implement a builder for the inventory? So again, I'm going to create a new class, and I'm going to call this inventory builder.
And just like before, the key here is that we're going to add a new method called build that returns an inventory. Now, this is a little trickier because the inventory actually has an overload to its constructor. It could either take just an integer that represents the capacity of the inventory, or it could take a capacity and a set of parameters that represent an array of bags. So knowing that, why don't we go ahead and add two new private member variables to the inventory builder class. One will be an int to represent the capacity, and the other will be an array of bags. And then we can go ahead and pass those into the new inventory. Now, of course, we want to be able to expose these on the builder, so we'll add two new methods, both of which will return the inventory builder. And one will be, again, with capacity, which will set the private member variable and return this. And then another one, which will allow us to set the bags. So we'll call this with bags. And when we add this into the inventory test, you'll see how we can actually chain these together and how nice that looks. Now, we're almost done. There's one little caveat here. There is a chance that with bags won't actually get called, so our bags array will be null. In this case, we're just going to do a null check, and we're going to instantiate a new array of bags with the capacity in that scenario, because we don't want to have to force the user to call with bags on the builder every time. All right, let's switch back to the inventory tests. And now we can replace this call to the inventory constructor with a call to a new inventory builder. And again, we'll say with capacity, and we'll also say with bags now. Pass in the bag, and then call build. All right, I can see the look on your face, and don't worry. Now we're going to add the syntactic sugar, starting by encapsulating these two builders into some classes that will read a little bit better. So first thing we're going to do is create a new class file called builders. And in this class file, we're going to add two static classes, one called a, and another one called un. And this will be made clear in a moment. So we're going to have a bag and an inventory. So I'm going to add a public static reference to a new bag builder in the class called bag. It's going to return a new bag builder. And then I'm going to do the same thing for inventory in the un class, an inventory. Now you might be wondering why I'm calling an inventory builder an inventory, and that'll be made clear in a moment. But first things first, we can go back to our inventory tests, and now we no longer have to call this instantiation logic. We can just call a.bag. And same with the inventory builder, we can call uninventory. All right, so that's looking a little bit better, but I really want to encapsulate the idea of a builder. I don't even want you to really know that there's a builder being associated with this test. All I want you to be concerned with as someone who's reading this test in the future is that I've got a bag with a capacity of one, and I've got an inventory with a capacity of one with this set of bags. So the next thing we're going to do is get rid of this call to dot build. And a really cool way we can do that is with an implicit cast. So let's go on over to the bag builder, and we're going to add a new method. It's going to be a public static implicit operator that returns a bag. And so this method takes a bag builder, call this builder, and what we can do is just simply return builder.build. Okay, so with this implicit operator in place, we can go back to our inventory tests and remove the call to dot build. Now, what's happening here is that this variable holds a bag builder, but when you pass the bag builder into a method that expects a list of bags, it's implicitly casting them to bags. Now, to sort of get ahead of this, we can change this from a var and explicitly call this a bag, and that call to dot build and the implicit cast operator will happen right here. And to be honest, I kind of like this a little bit better because when you're reading tests, you want everything to be very, very explicit. All right, so let's go on over to the inventory builder and we'll do the same thing. Again, we're going to add a public static implicit operator that returns an inventory, takes in an inventory builder. And again, it's going to return a call to builder.build. Okay, now we can go back to the inventory tests and go ahead and remove the call to .build. And then instead of using var, we're going to explicitly call this what it is, an inventory. And that should look a little bit better. And if we fast forward a little bit and scroll through this code, we can see that it's much cleaner. And hopefully anyone who comes along in the future and has to debug one of these tests when they break will have a very clear idea of what's going on.
And there you have it. Wow, this is great. It's so much more expressive and way easier to follow. And it's easier to maintain too. Now, if you make a change to your constructor or the class itself, you only need to update one place in your test suite. Thanks for the help. And thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it or found it helpful, the best thing you can do to help support this channel is to share it with a friend. And of course, like, leave a comment, and subscribe for more content just like this.
Last but not least, a special shout out to my top patrons, Wayne Glows, Trond, Thomas, NZ, Dark Rush Photography, and Breck.